Hey guys, this is Chubbs, and today I just wanted to talk to you about and show you a new first-person shooter that's been released, and this is called Takedown Red Sabre. Now, Takedown is a tactical close-quarter shooter, much like the older Rainbow Six titles, like Rainbow Six 3 and previous to that, and also some of the SWAT games like SWAT 3 and SWAT 4. So if you've never played those games before, basically they're close quarters combat focused, and they're very tactical and very intense as well, because enemies can kill you in one shot, and you have to really take each room very carefully, and you have to use a lot of teamwork and a lot of tactics, and it's a lot different than, say, Call of Duty and something like that, because you just have to play it in a whole different way. So this is the first type of game that we've had like that since probably the early to mid 2000s, and this is a title from Cyril and LLC, which is a brand new developer as well. This is a small developer that's made up of industry veterans. Some of the guys have worked on past Ghost Recon titles, Halo Reach, Fear, so they have a lot of AAA experience. And this actually got its start on Kickstarter. They ran a campaign, they were successful with it, and the game is now released on Steam for $15. So this is a look at the finished version. This is not alpha or beta or early access or any of that crap. This is the finished product here. So anyways, I'm just going to show you what all this game has in it. First, you can go in and you can customize your loadouts. They give you 4 loadout slots, and something that this game does that's kind of different is it starts you off with all of the gear, like the weapons and attachments, without you having to unlock them or, you know, grind to get them or any of that. So I really like that you can just hop right in and just choose exactly what you want. So you can choose different primary weapons, like you can see here. You have SMGs, assault rifles, you can see the AK variants, shotguns, and with each weapon you have different ammo types as well. You also have different optics for each weapon. So let's go here. I'm going to find a weapon with a lot of optics. Like, you can have a hollow reflex sight, a combat scope, night vision scope, different things like that. Or you can just go with iron sights. You can also have a silencer if you like to go stealthy. You can choose different pistols for your secondary. You can choose different armor, like light armor. Doesn't protect you hardly any, but it doesn't make much noise at all. Then if you go up to heavy armor, it protects you the most, but it also makes the most noise, and it also prevents you from sprinting, so it's going to hurt your mobility. And you have 2 equipment slots. Now, both of these slots have the same options available, and these 3 options are frag grenades, flashbang grenades, and breaching charges. Now, this part of the game, the equipment is actually one of the things I'm disappointed with. I really hoped for more options, and I also hoped for more tactical devices that you could use. SWAT 4, for example, had an Opti-Wand that you could use to kind of peek under doors and see who was inside that room on like a little video camera without having to open the door and reveal yourself. And you could also even use it to peek around corners as well without having to poke out. And it also had door wedges that you could use to jam up doors, and that way you could keep enemies from coming through a door behind you or something like that. So I really wish this game included cool little devices like that just to help you out. But as it stands, you're very limited. You basically just have these 2 types of grenades and breaching charges, which are unfortunately almost worthless, and I'm going to show you guys why that is once we get into the gameplay. So let's back out of the loadout screen and let's look at the options that you have when it comes to playing the game. So Takedown is definitely a game that's best experienced in co-op. This is not a game that's really geared towards playing against other people, although it does have deathmatch and things like that. This is definitely a co-op oriented game, and to get the most out of it, you're going to want to play it online with other people. Now, unfortunately, at this time, they're having a lot of issues with this server browser. You'll see, for example, that although these servers have people in them, they all say 0 out of 12 players, which is not true. I've had a lot of trouble joining games. When I try to join them, it'll usually just boot me back out to the main menu without giving me any message or anything. Sometimes it'll just crash, and just really they're having a lot of trouble with it, and hopefully they'll have that patched here soon. So since they're struggling with the online component right now, what I can do is I can show you the single player component that they've included. So thankfully, if you just want to play it by yourself without having to worry about fiddling with the servers while they're having those issues, you can play with the AI teammates and just kind of get a feel for the game and kind of practice. So you have three single player game modes. You have Mission, which is a narrative based game mode where you have like a backstory for each map, and then you have a set of objectives based on that backstory. You have Tango Hunt, which is basically a very simplistic game mode where you just have enemies just randomly scattered throughout levels, and then you have to kill all the enemies to win. And you have a game mode called Bomb Disarm, which is really kind of a middle ground between Mission and Tango Hunt, where you have enemies randomly thrown around like Tango Hunt, but you also have an objective in that you have to disarm several bombs. So it's kind of like a nice mixture of Tango Hunt and Mission. If you want to just have a simple objective, just disarm bombs and also kill enemies. Now my favorite is Mission, just because it gives you a nice narrative and basically objectives that are unique to each map. Now speaking of the maps, something else that really sets this game apart is it allows you to choose the maps, aka the levels, in any order. So it's not a campaign. You don't have to play through the levels in a very specific order or anything like that. Each map is almost like its own scenario, which is like an experience unto itself. It's like a separate experience. There's no overarching story or characters or anything like that. So these are just kind of like scenarios. So the different ones you have to choose from are Biolab, which is like an indoor kind of science lab environment. HQ, which is like a large office complex. Radar Base, which is set out in the Arctic. You can see there it's kind of like a base that's up on these tall platforms. Cargo Ship, which is as the name states, it's on a large cargo ship, and it's set at nighttime. And Facility, which is it's almost like a large missile facility. It has a lot of verticality and a lot of wide open spaces, so it kind of takes place, the combat in it kind of takes place at longer ranges than in any of the other maps. And finally, the last two are just two different training missions. These are just kind of to help you get adjusted to the game and things like that. So really the ones that you're going to focus on are just these five, Biolab through Facility. So let's go with Biolab first, and I'm going to let you guys listen to this briefing and watch the video that kind of accompanies it here.
Gear up, folks. We're coming in hot on this one. Neogen's bioweapons lab has been compromised. Exposure of the company's research into bioweapons would negatively affect Neogen's image, and that is why they're activating our contract. We've locked down the local police and media, so you have full coverage for a loud insertion. Disarm the bombs and get clear. The Tangos are dressed as Neogen security, armed with SMGs, and have planted bombs throughout the building and are threatening to blow the facility. We suspect they're using the bombs as a cover to access and expose the research that Neogen has been doing into bioweapons. Disarm the bombs and lock down the server, then get clear. Choose your insertion through the underground garage or through the roof.
All right, so this is one of the things that I really like about this game. I'm really glad that they did this. This is kind of a throwback to the mission briefings and the SWAT games and Rainbow Six. It's really cool how they have a narrative and they actually get someone to read it for you as well. And then they have a video here that gives you a glimpse at the level, so you kind of know what to expect. And it usually will show you the enemies that you're up against, what they're armed with. And like here, for example, you see a security camera feed. You know that's what the enemies look like. And here's a little video of the bombs that I need to disarm, so I'll know what they look like. So it's just really nice that they included that. And they've done this for all of the missions, so that's a great touch. It's really one of my favorite parts of the game. So at this biolab mission gives me three objectives. I have to disarm three bombs, I have to lock down a server, and then I have to get up to the rooftop to be extracted. Now, speaking of the rooftop, in this game, much like in SWAT, you can choose between your insertion points. So I can choose to be inserted on the rooftop and come in from above, or I can choose to come in from the parking garages kind of down below. So I'm going to go with the rooftop, and here you can just choose what loadout you have and how many AI teammates you have. If you want to kind of handicap yourself, you can uncheck these and have fewer than three teammates, but I like to have all three with me. And now that we've selected everything, got it set up, let's go ahead and launch it.
Cover your six and make sure you don't get flanked.
So this game's load times are thankfully very fast. This runs on the Unreal 3 engine, as you probably could see there by the textures loading in. That's a problem that seems to be common with this engine. And already I see an enemy here in this doorway, so I'm going to deal with him really quick. I've got three squad mates following in behind me. These are all controlled by the AI, so none of these are actual players or actual human beings. So let's see if I can take this guy out. Got him. Sounds like some other guys are alerted here. So after I take care of this situation, I'm going to kind of go over the squad controls and some of my disappointments with that, actually. So that guy was just kind of staring at the door for whatever reason. I see some other guys moving here through the window of this door. So you gotta be careful and go about this slowly. You'll notice that I'm peeking around corners a lot, and I'm not rushing in and just going guns blazing. It's best to take a slow approach, otherwise you're gonna get shot and killed before you know it. This is a dangerous spot here, because I've got a door that's opening and a stairway too that I could be shot from, so I've got two directions I could be hit from here. But I'm sure you could, if you've played Rainbow Six 3, I'm sure you can already see the similarities here. It's got a very similar style of gameplay. It's definitely more like Rainbow Six 3 gameplay-wise than SWAT. Because unlike SWAT, you're pretty much just killing everybody on site if they have a gun, and pretty much everybody does have a gun. There aren't any civilians unless you're on a hostage mission, and this is not one of those missions, so pretty much I'm shooting everybody I see. And in SWAT, you always had to kind of abide by SWAT rules, so you had to yell at enemies to comply before you open fire, things like that. This game is not so much about that. This is definitely more of a direct confrontation game where you pretty much just tactically go in and just eliminate guys. But now that this situation is more or less under control, let me get these guys out of the doorway here. Let me bring them all into this room. So now that I've got that under control, I just wanted to show you guys what you can do with your squad. And this is actually one of the game's limitations and another one of its disappointments. You're very limited as to how you can control them. You can tell them to follow you, or you can tell them to hold their position like this.
Holding.
So I've got them set up now to where they will hold their position and just kind of stand there. And if I go across into here, you'll see that they're just staying where they're at.
Copy.
Then I can tell them to follow me again. So you can do that, and then you can also change their rules of engagement.
Going quiet.
So going quiet.
On offense.
Going offense.
On defense.
Going defense. And although you can change those rules of engagement, I've not noticed it have any effect on the way they actually behave. I don't know if it's just a really subtle thing. I don't know if it's just not coded into the game for whatever reason. The audio cue's certainly there, but like I said, I've not noticed any difference in their behavior. And really, those are the only two things you can do, is just tell them to either hold or follow you, and change their rules of engagement, which again doesn't appear to actually even do anything. So you can't order these guys to stack up on doors. You can't tell them where to go. And I just got gunned down. See, that's what happens when you carelessly go in. You just And I'm under attack from all directions here. Looks like my entire squad got wiped out. So let's restart, see if we can do better here, and I'll continue to kind of discuss the game. But that moment there shows just how careful you have to be. I kind of went about it carelessly, and we got ambushed and got kind of caught in a crossfire there. And before you knew it, everybody, all four of us had died. So it looks like we've got enemies here again. Something that's kind of interesting, though, is even in mission mode, the enemies are randomly placed. So sometimes you'll have more enemies in this section here, for example, than others. So you have to always be on your toes. You're not going to know for sure exactly how many guys you're going to be up against in certain areas. So you've always got to keep your guard up. But like I was saying there before we got ambushed and killed, it's really disappointing that you can't command these guys. You can't order them to go to certain places. You can't order them to breach doors, to stack up on doors, to throw grenades. They're just extremely basic. Basically, all the AI will do is just follow you like this unless you tell them to stay put, and they just tag behind and just kill anybody who tries to flank you. And that's really about the extent of the squad mate AI in this game. It's just very, very basic, very underwhelming, and very disappointing. So you can see the incompetence of them there. I was being shot by a guy down the stairs. These three stooges were just apparently just off in their own world. So. Yeah, the way you want to experience this game to get the most out of it is definitely to play with other people. Otherwise, you're gonna have to deal with these brain dead AI idiots working with you. This is definitely not the ideal way to experience this game. I just want to put that out there.
Tango down. Going high.
So I hear a lot of shouting. We've got a lot of activity. I'm kind of taking the same route that I did last time, just to see if it will work out better for us.
Moving up.
Sounds like we got some activity here.
Checking on something.
Michael, I'm moving now.
Now, since I'm here at a good place where I can show the bullet penetration, this game actually has The bullets in this game can actually penetrate certain surfaces. So depending on the ammo type, they can penetrate walls of certain thickness. So this weapon here, if I shoot through this door, you can see that it actually went through and hit. If I try to shoot through this wall here, let's see if it'll penetrate. So see, I can't penetrate this wall. Some weapons might be able, or some ammo might be able to, but a lot of objects in this game can be penetrated with certain rounds, so you're not always safe just because you're hiding behind a wall or behind an object. Bullets very well can penetrate what you're behind much of the time, so you have to be really careful. Something else this game has is a system where, depending on the length of your weapon, when you get up to a wall, like if I get up to this wall here, your weapon will go down. If your weapon is rubbing up against the wall, So this is a shorter weapon here, so I can get pretty close to this wall. But if I was carrying, say, a sniper rifle, I would not be able to get as close to this wall before I was forced to have my gun down. And that leaves you vulnerable in close quarter situations. So that's kind of an interesting mechanic this game has, forcing your weapon down if you're up against the wall, that a lot of games just don't seem to have. So I'm caught in another bad situation here in the same spot where I was last time. And this actually leads me to a good point here that I really meant to make prior to this little confrontation. And that is something that really bothers me about this game, and that I have no idea why the developers did it, is notice that every door that I've seen, I notice that I've really not had to open any doors. Now, the only door that I've really interacted with was the one that I came through at the bottom of those stairs that automatically slid open. Now, every other door, like these doors with the handles, are always automatically open at the start of each level. So, again, I have no idea why the developers did this. It makes no sense to me. But every door that you have to manually open that's not an automatically door, like an automatic opening door, is wide open at the start of the level. Now, this presents... hold on just a second here. Let me... I hear some talk. Yeah, I thought there was somebody around there. Let's see if there's anybody else. Got him. He fired a shot at me. I got very lucky there. But as I was saying there before the AI interrupted me, if these stooges would get out of my way here, is the doors are all wide open like this. So... as a result, remember that I said earlier that the breaching charges are absolutely worthless? Well, this is why I said that. The doors are always open, so, I mean, think about it. Why would you ever use a breaching charge? The point of a breaching charge is to come up to a door that's closed, but that has enemies behind it, potentially. And that way, you can put the charge on the door, you can blow it open, and then you can disorient or even kill the guys behind the door, and give you an advantage for when you storm in the room. Well, you really can't do that because the doors are already open in this game. And so not only does it make breaching charges worthless, since you really don't come up to closed doors that you can breach, it also results in it takes away that element of surprise of not knowing what's going to be behind the door. Like, see, I have that element of surprise with this door here. These are the only doors that you can really interact with, these automatic ones. I don't know what's going to be behind them. So it's really exciting to go through them because you don't know what exactly you're going to run up on. See, right here, I didn't know what was going to be behind it when it opened. But these doors here are wide open, so you're always forced to be able to look through the opening, and you know what's going to be behind it without having to open it. That takes away a tactical aspect that SWAT 3, 4 had, and Rainbow Six 3 had, that is sorely missed. It just takes away so many tactical moves. Like, you can't come up to a door that's closed, for example, and chuck a grenade inside. Walk up to it, open it, chuck a grenade inside, and then close it. And then open it after the grenade has gone off. You can't do things like that. It feels really limiting. And it also, something I used to like to do in SWAT is I would, each time I cleared an area, I would purposely leave the doors open just as a visual reminder that I had been there. Well, you can't do that in this game really because the doors are already all open for you. So as a result, it kind of makes it tricky to know which areas you've already explored and things like that. So these are just kind of like my minor, or I wouldn't even say minor, I would say major gripes with the gameplay. Something else that I have a problem with too is the lean system. I love that you can lean in this game. However, if you come up to a corner like this, let's say I'm right here and I need to scoot around the corner, the only way to do it is to tap the key and kind of awkwardly do this wobble like you're seeing right now. You can't lean and walk at the same time, because when you try to walk, see, it straightens you back up, and then when you stop, you lean again. And it's so silly when you go around corners because you're doing this kind of unrealistic wobble. I really wish that they would give you the ability to slowly walk while leaning without breaking the lean. But I feel like you guys have kind of seen enough of this level. I've not explored all of it. In fact, this is only like just a small part of it. This is just one floor. So what I'm going to do, I'm just going to back out to the main menu and just show you guys one more level, just to kind of show you the variety of levels this game has. Let's go to one of my favorite levels that I've played. That is the radar base. I think this is one of the most unique, and I'll let you listen to this briefing.
This is a black op. An Arctic research facility in international territory has discovered something, and our employer wants it. Secure the package and extract, and under no circumstances open it. We have legal cover for this op, but ensure that no civilian workers are harmed. Armed resistance can be met with deadly force. A PMC is guarding the facility, so expect heavily armed, armored, and trained opposition. We will insert over land so as not to expose you. In addition to securing the package, we need you to sabotage the communications dish and wipe the record of the station's radar track before extraction.
All right. So, as you heard there in that briefing, these guys are going to be heavily armed and armored. So, as a result, the loadout that I'm using right now is probably not going to be optimal for this. I probably would need to choose a weapon that hits a little bit harder, but this mission does have some more interesting objectives. I have to secure a package, I have to go to a terminal and wipe data from it, I have to go disable a dish, and then I have to get to this helipad that you see here to be extracted. So this is a little bit more complex, and once again I can choose two extraction points. I'm going to choose this one here at the bottom, and I'll stick with this same setup. And again, you'll see just how fast the load times are. So we're starting out here at the bottom, so we can go up either way. This is very non-linear here. You can pretty much go about this any way. And this is kind of a longer range combat level. This would be good for sniper rifles. I already see some guys up there walking around, I think. Well, that was actually a little radar thing spinning around. This is one of the only levels that has doors that are closed. See, every door should be like this right here. But once you go inside this place, you'll find that all of the indoor doors are open, wide open. See this door right here? Wide open. And once again, I don't know why the developers made that choice. That just... Another door wide open. See, that is so baffling to me why they would make the doors like that. See, I should be able to come up to this door and determine how I'm going to enter it. The door should look like this, and I should be able to come up, peek inside like this, determine whether we're going to breach it, determine whether we're going to just go in just like we normally would like this, determine whether we're going to throw a flashbang in it and then go inside it. And it's like it eliminates so much of the tactical play having the doors open. I know I've probably talked more about doors in this video than anything else, but it's amazing just how much it limits what you can do in the game. Something as simple as that, it just really hurts it. So we caught that guy by surprise. This is a really cool level because
man down.
That guy just got wiped out. But this is a neat level because each building that you enter here has a whole bunch of rooms, and you have several of these buildings across it. This is a pretty large level, and I think my whole squad is just about wiped out. I think this might be the only guy left. Hopefully I can kill this guy here and step outside and survive long enough to show you guys how large this area is. so you can see these guys are outfitted differently. Oh! The AI just came through the door and just blew me away. So let's restart. And let's take a different path this time. Instead of going up that same set of stairs, let's go up this set of stairs up here. So you can see how large that radar dish is. So I can go up to this area here and enter that door. I can enter this door here, and this is another building. We can go all the way across here and get on these platforms. So this is a pretty large level. You can see I'm trying to fight these guys at long range, but this is not a very accurate weapon for long range combat, so it's definitely not ideal. And as you can see, I mean, it's difficult to really do anything tactically as well, because the AI just is so basic. You have so little control over them. And when you're playing by yourself like this, it really just feels like you're kind of just doing everything on your own. It doesn't really feel like you can work as a team very much. And you're more or less just kind of going around just killing guys. I'll kind of repeat myself again. This is the type of game that you'll definitely want to play with other human beings in order to get the absolute best experience. Playing co-op with other people is just unmatched. It's far more fun. But I feel like you guys have seen enough of this to understand what the gameplay's like. You can see how lethal it is, that if you make even a slight mistake, the AI will pretty much just gun you down in an instant. I'm gonna try and get across here and enter this other building. I really like this Arctic environment here. This is a real unique map altogether, I think. See, that's something I like about this game. I like the map design. I think it's really cool how the locations look. I think the graphics are pretty good. A lot of people have been complaining about them, especially the animations, but I think they're serviceable for what the game does. I think they're just fine. The load times are fantastic. The controls are very, very good. It's very fluid. And I meant to show you guys something else as well. You have a flashlight you can use for dark areas if you don't have the night vision scope. You can also change firing modes. I'm in fully auto now. I can switch to single shot or burst. So you have different firing modes. Just in case you were wondering about that. And yeah, I think this pretty much covers it. So if you guys have any questions about this game, be sure to let me know. As it stands, I'm quite disappointed by it overall. I think it does a lot of really cool things. I like how lethal the combat is. I like the way the weapons feel. I like the way the levels are designed. What I don't like, just kind of a summary, I don't like the lean system, how you can't smoothly lean out like this and look for guys. I don't like how every door is wide open in most of these levels by default. I don't like that you can't control your squad mates. You don't have much control over them. It feels like they're pretty much just brain dead lemmings that just kind of follow you around. Those are definitely my main gripes, and I hope that they get the server browser issues ironed out. But if somehow they could improve those issues, I think this has a chance to be a great game, a great tactical game, and they're going to add modding support. So who knows, maybe modders will go in there and give the AI more commands that you can order or commands that you can issue, and turn this into a completely different game that shines just as much as Rainbow Six 3 and SWAT 3 and SWAT 4 did. Those are some of the best tactical shooters ever made. But again, this is Chubbs signing out. If you guys have any questions, just let me know.